Earnan, you were just over in Ireland, in Dublin, at the Irish government conference that the government organized under the presidency, the EU presidency. The conference was on hunger, nutrition, and climate justice. Big nouns, high-level speakers, and strong demands that they put forward there. Did that conference deliver in terms of its aim to inform on a new approach for the post-MDG discussion?
I suppose in terms of the big ideas, you know, the critical one, I think, is this one about justice and equity. And that message came over very, very strongly. The idea, I mean, clearly the idea around climate is that there is an injustice involved in the impacts of climate change being largely borne by people who have very little to do with creating the problem of climate change in the first place. But also very clearly, the idea was put forward strongly by lots of people, including the Irish president, you know, very senior people, as well as the grassroots participants, that hunger is a justice problem as well, you know, and that hunger and ongoing malnutrition, that these are really the result of political failures rather than and poverty and inequality rather than kind of technical failures on not knowing what to do. And I think that message got across very strongly. There were other really, that's kind of at a big picture level, but practical things too about the importance of local knowledge and local experience and the need to match that up with scientific and more formal sorts of research. That was certainly emphasized as well. And in the outcomes from the conference, these sorts of things were emphasized, you know, the need to make those connections, the need also to not only to hear what people from local level are saying, but to get resources directed down to local level to support local initiatives and local problem solving. So, you know, there's calls, for example, to get climate finance delivered to local level as well as ODA. Also, I think the idea of joining up issues around hunger and food security on one hand with issues around climate change, and there were commitments made by some of the senior participants there to ensure that hunger becomes an issue in the UNFCCC process, and that climate becomes a significant issue in the post 2015 framework. I suppose the other big thing was the instrumentality, the importance of empowering people. You know, the importance of producers' organisations having voices in policy making and the policy making processes should be inclusive. That was also very strong.
Yeah.
So in that sense, it succeeded, I think, in getting those things across. It was much more focused on that, on the sort of the politics of the problem and the making the connections and getting the communication going.
As far as I recall, there was also the aim to collect some practical samples in terms of how you could respond to people's lives and support, come up with more hands-on strategies for coping with hunger and climate change. Did you see that happening?
Well, they had these quite good, what they called learning circles, I suppose, and where again you had this mix between senior level policymakers and practitioners, and the discussions there were based on case studies, real examples that people that had been written up beforehand and that people who were involved in were there to talk about. And I think that was useful. I mean, the time was very short to kind of turn practical case study example into policy messages. But I think it was probably very useful for the interchange between people from different parts of the developing world and initiatives from relevant from one group in, I don't know, Latin America or somewhere to another one in Africa. I think the messages for the bigger process, for say the post 2015 or indeed the UNFCCC. I think the messages are there, but they weren't so much about the technicalities of how you solve things. It was more about, as I said earlier, the politics and the need to do things around empowerment. And I would suspect that those will be the issues that that go forward.
There was also, obviously, as you said, the politics. There was quite a strong message there that policies are the things that can actually do change things. On the example of what Ireland had experienced and having a agriculture being solely dependent on potatoes, and then policy change that changed that, and these sort of things came out. Do you think that the other aim to inform the MDG discussion, was that, from your point of view, picked up properly?
In terms of the MDGs, it certainly points to the need to be looking at issues around, looking at targets and indicators around governance and around political inclusion of poor and vulnerable people, and, you know, as being important for both food security and for reducing the impacts and vulnerabilities to climate change. Of course, those are systemic sort of things. They won't only benefit food security and dealing with climate change, but they'll benefit other areas. But I think they probably are critical. And I expect some of the participants of the conference to follow up very strongly on those aspects in the process up to 2015.
Earnan, you've been speaking about two things already there, the MDG debate and food security. My observation was, personal observation, if you might, that the notion of food security, at least on the high-level panels and the speeches, was not there as often as I would have expected maybe half a year ago. And we having also that discussion of whether food security should become a separate goal of the new NDGs and so forth. Do you think that food security as a sort of en vogue term has slipped off a little bit?
Well, I think there, at the conference, certainly there was a strong commitment and desire to have nutrition targets included in the in the new framework. And I think also, you know, there is this general idea on the need to for the post 2015 framework to look at not only what is to be achieved in terms of targets, but also how to get there, what sort of things you need to do. So I suspect it isn't my impression that the general idea of food security will be off the agenda, but I think we may need to think about food security beyond maybe some of the traditional targets that we have used in the past, and so thinking about things like nutritional outcomes, particularly for particular groups, having targets around those, and also having targets around some of the things like we were talking about. Like governance and inclusion. There was a very interesting set of information available, made available at the conference, and it's well worth having a look at the documentation. It's all admirably brief, but very, very, very informative.
What do you think can be done as a result of the Dublin conference?
I was quite impressed by the level of political commitment that the Irish government showed afterwards, and I'm not saying that because I'm Irish. I wasn't involved at all in the event, but the statements that were made at the end of the conference by the Irish Foreign Minister were very strong on using the role that Ireland has at the moment in terms of the presidency of the European Union. And also its role as co-facilitator for the UN General Assembly event on the MDGs this year. And the Foreign Minister committed to using those actively to bring the messages from the conference trying to get them reflected in the process. So I would expect, it was a very public commitment as well, and made in front of an audience which you can be quite sure will follow up to see that it is done. So I would expect to see something there. He also referred to the G8 process and the upcoming London summit on hunger, which will be before the G8 summit. I'd expect to see the Irish trying to push some of these kind of justice and equity issues and empowerment issues, as well as a strong focus on nutritional outcomes.
Any key takeaways from the conference for the platform members being donors looking towards the September United Nations General Assembly and everything that the next stepping stone there in terms of the MDG process?
Well, I think a lot of the issues that we discuss in the donor platform fall under the agenda that was being discussed. I think, the key ones would seem to me the ones about knowledge and science and the need to, make sure that whatever we do in terms of research, but also in terms of policy analysis, that is connected to, that is done locally, and is done in ways that that is useful for local people as well as for policymakers. So some good examples of that. So there's a bit of an agenda there around research and innovation. I think the other thing. The big takeaway for platform members would be about funding and how to deliver funding and to try to get it to local level. Even while delivering through national programs, in support of national programs for food security, to ensure that those programs actually deliver funds to local level and in support of. In support of local initiative and local process. Space, creating space for producers' organisations, presumably for traders' organisations, and those sorts of things, and providing support to them, I think is also important. So, and that involves kind of matching up what you're doing in different places, the support that you are providing to civil society or to producers' organisations, matching that up with what you're doing through other parts of your food security programming. There were a couple of other issues. Obviously, policy coherence for development types of issues came up as well. The need for us to think about the correct global policies and the correct policies in our own countries that would be supported. Of these, there was quite a lot of the speakers spoke on the, as I said earlier, on the whole idea of the political failure and the injustice. And the Irish president spoke very strongly about the need for international regulatory frameworks in things like agricultural commodity markets, to protect people and to do something about to reduce price volatility and the perverse impacts on people's livelihoods of what goes on in global markets.